Nu mă întreba cum am făcut primul milion. Așa sună o zicală americană care pare să spună că este imposibil să ai succes în afaceri fără să faci compromisuri. Există însă și oameni de afaceri care se ghidează după alte principii. Ei cred că se poate să ai succes în afaceri și fără să faci compromisuri, pentru că, în opinia lor, există lucruri mai importante în viață decât succesul în afaceri. Chris Jones, un businessman din Anglia, a ales să intre în lumea afacerilor urmând principii pe care mulți oameni le evită.
My name is Chris Jones. I work in London as a businessman and a consultant as a quantity surveyor, and I've been working in the rail sector for the last 5 or 6 years. I became a Christian when I was 13, brought up in a Christian family, and it wasn't until I was in my early 20s and I was going to a church in London that I actually realized the practicalities of living a Christian life in today's world. A businessman has two roles. One is, firstly, to actually be the head of a company and run the company as a businessman. The second would be to have a senior management position within that company and to run the company on, as a Christian, on Christian morals and ethics within that business, both as the owner of the business and secondly as a senior manager within the business. If people are, as a Christian businessman in the Christian world, if they are the leader of the company and if they are the owner of the company, people will generally do, not always, but generally do what the boss wants to achieve greater financial reward. My feeling is the bigger challenge comes when you're in middle management as a Christian businessman and you haven't got a Christian boss who doesn't understand your Christian principles and ethics. And those are the very hard issues of reality. How do you actually run your business on Christian and moral grounds as a senior business person in a middle management role? And I found through my experience, just living your life for Christ, doing the right thing, people can't tell you to do the wrong thing. Where possibilities have existed for people to tell you to do the wrong thing, yes, I can think of one or two situations where I did lose my contract. My contract was terminated because I didn't want to do what I was asked to do. But I have to say, through all this, I've been very fortunate and I've been very well looked after, and I've had lots of various situations where I've learnt a lot and I've been able to live my life for Christ, and the Lord has been very good to me. Sometimes it's often better, if you are in that position, to go bankrupt, because you can minimise your losses and not dig yourself in a greater hole. If you try somehow or other to lie and cheat your way through the situation, you can sometimes end up in a bigger hole. And if you look at what the Apostle Paul went through for preaching the gospel, there he was in prison, in chains. He was witnessing to some of the guards, the most intimidating people you could ever come across. He was prepared in any situation he was in to actually live and witness his life for Christ, irrespective of the suffering that went on. And I have to say, is that how I should live my life, led by Paul's example? The answer is yes, and to live by Paul's example for witnessing and preaching the gospel to all those people in Ephesus and Corinth and Athens and so on and so forth. The question is my life focused enough on Christ to let that happen, or is it not focused enough on Christ to do other things? That for me is the question. I hope I'm able to live a Christ-focused life in that situation. How do you look at wealth, and how do you value wealth, and how do you handle the wealth? I think the first principle is that everything that is created in this world has come from God. God created it. So everything that's generated from that is His. Christ gave His life, therefore how much do we owe Him for that on the cross? Everything that we have comes from God. The issue for the Christian is whether you love the use of money that it's given you, or whether you actually use it for practical reasons, to actually want to help people in difficult financial situations, in deserving financial situations. Are we focused on greed, to have as much money as we can have stuck away in a bank account? Or do we want to be given the money that we can then use to win other people for Christ, to use it in outreach events, to use it for dinner parties, to use it in church growth, to use it in church construction projects? It's the use of the money and the love for money and the greed for the money that should be the main focus of attention for the Christian on how they use that money. And after all, working in construction, everything that we have around us has actually come out of the ground. Everything came out of the earth that God has created. So all the rail projects I'm involved with has been created out of the ground, and the money and wealth that has been given to us by the Lord should be used for the further development of the gospel of Christ in this world that we live in. Today's pressures in today's societies can be as great for the rich man as it can be for the poor man. The issues that exist are just different issues. The rich man has different issues. He's probably got the poor people after him for the money. But the issues are different. The wealth is different. What do you do with the wealth? The more wealth you've got, you've got the taxation issue. You've got all sorts of issues over the wealth that you've given, that you've been given by the Lord. The issues are just different, I believe. And for the average individual earning an average salary, a lot of the issues are far, far less. Because the more you have, the more materially things that you have, the more you have to do to service those things that you have. They cost money. You've got to employ people. You've got to trust people. The issues become bigger. And if you're an average person earning an average salary in the UK, the issues are a lot less. You can bring up the average family quite comfortably in the UK. The world apparently has enough resources to go around. There's enough basic nutritional material, I understand, to be spread evenly throughout the world. But that balance isn't carried out. It's an imbalance. And the one thing that I have noticed, where you travel around the world, particularly, say, in Africa, where you've got a large level of poverty, but also you've got a strong level of Christian conviction. You've got a lot of people coming to Christ. Where poverty is also at its greatest, in places like South America, I understand it's the largest growing country or continent in the world, that with people coming to Christ. So the level of poverty perhaps indicates a reliability more on God than on Christ. There are people coming to Christ in these countries. Some of the hardest countries to actually focus on and win people for Christ are places like England, where there's a large number of fairly well-off society, where people needn't starve, where the government will help people out. I can't see any situation where a church would want to be a business in the secular world, because then that is taking the focus away from the church. It's taking the focus away from the aims and goals of winning and holding people for Christ into other aims and goals, i.e. profit. And the church isn't about profit. The church is actually about winning people for Christ, to see people in heaven. That's the aim of the church. It's to do with its teaching, its preaching, its relationships within the members of the church, to build each member of the church up in the body of Christ. That is the aim and goal of the church as I see it.